Okay, see what I will do is Perron's theorem. Okay, today Perron's theorem. Okay, Perron's theorem is about square matrices in which all entries are positive real numbers. Okay, such matrices will be called positive matrices. That's the word that I will be using, positive matrices. So positive matrices means it's a first of all note one point. I'm not dealing anything about rectangular matrices, only square matrices. Okay, so all the entries are going to be positive real numbers and proved by Perron. I'm not very sure about this year and all. I just took it from Wikipedia, so you can verify whether the year is correct or not later on. Maybe see at least around that time it's proved. Okay, 1907 by Oscar Perron, and then Frobenius comes into the picture in 1912, extending this theorem into much more general setting. Okay, okay, see before telling something, somehow before stating the theorem precisely, I'll just somehow use the following tell the notations that I will be using here. So let A, if A is an n by n matrix, then the ijth entry will be denoted by aij. Okay, so A, capital A stands for the matrix, ijth entry is denoted by aij. Okay, so we will write A in this fashion. Okay, a square bracket and then inside aij. So A will be called positive if aij is positive for every ij. Okay, that's very clear. So whatever I told you in the beginning, so A is a positive matrix and so on. So let me follow this notation. This notation is also quite standard. A is bigger than 0. Okay, A is bigger than 0 if and only if A is positive. Okay, A is positive. So it's a very short notation for positive matrices. Okay, A will be called non-negative if Aij is greater than or equal to 0. Okay, some entries I am allowing it to be 0. Okay, Aij greater than or equal to 0 for every ij. Even if one entry is negative, I am not going to consider that matrix. Remember this one. Okay, so let me write A greater than or equal to 0 if and only if A is non-negative. Okay, positive matrices or non-negative matrices, trivial. Okay, all positive or non-negative. 0, 1, 0, 0 is a non-negative but not positive. Why? Three entries are zeros. Okay, so it can't be positive. So okay, see, let A be an n by n real matrix. Okay, now I define something called f of x. Okay, f of x equal to determinant of xi minus a. The determinant of xi minus a. So there is a name given to this polynomial f. It is called characteristic polynomial of A. Okay, characteristic polynomial of A. Okay, F is monic. See, meaning for monic is that, see, if you observe this f of x, okay, it will be like this, x power in terms of, okay, entries of A. Okay, and it will be a polynomial of power. What will be the highest degree in that polynomial? It will be order. Okay, order of the matrix is what here? What is order of the matrix? N. Okay, it will be N, and x power n coefficient will be 1. Okay, so if I write in this way, okay, in this way, determinant of xi minus a, it takes care that f is monic. See, otherwise, if I define a characteristic polynomial in other way, determinant of a minus xi, then I have to take care of that coefficient and all. Okay, but in writing this way is convenient. So it takes care that f is always monic. Okay, degree of f is N. Okay, degree of f will be N. Okay, see, there exist some n complex numbers always, so that f of lambda I is 0. Why? What? N roots. Okay, see, first of all, see, can you solve any polynomial? Any real polynomial? No. Any non-constant polynomial, can you solve it?
guarantee that there is something.
It guarantee that?
There are where in all systems.
Okay. Okay, see those, see some of you who know this one fundamental theorem of algebra, it's all right. See otherwise, I will tell you this one, see one small thing here. See suppose you start with a matrix like this, A equal to 0, 1 minus 1, 0. Okay, A 1, 0, 1 minus 1, 0. What is the characteristic polynomial here? F of x is? X square plus 1, okay, x square plus 1. Okay, x square plus 1 equal to 0 if you try to solve it, okay. So, no real number will satisfy x square plus 1 equal to 0, okay. But anyway, if I try to solve it in the complex plane, okay, if I allow complex numbers, then it has a solution, I minus I, okay, I square plus 1 is 0, I square minus I square plus 1 is 0, okay, plus or minus I, okay. So, its a degree is a 2, okay, degree is a 2. I have lambda 1 equal to I, then lambda 2 equal to minus I, okay, there are two roots here. So, in general if you have an n by n matrix and you will be ending up with a polynomial of degree n and you can always get n complex numbers so that f of lambda I is 0, okay, this is called fundamental theorem of algebra, okay, it's proved in, it is proved in complex analysis course, okay, you can prove it, maybe first you will be proving Liouville's theorem, right, Liouville's theorem and then or even just the Cauchy integral formula is enough. If you know Cauchy integral formula, you can get this theorem, fundamental theorem algebra directly from that. Okay, anyway, see for our purpose it's enough, okay, there exists lambda 1, lambda 2 up to lambda n such that f of lambda is 0. So, keep this in mind always, okay. So, this is a fundamental thing that we are going to apply, okay. Okay, and second thing, see these numbers are called, okay, lambda 1, lambda 2 up to lambda n, they are called eigenvalues of A. There exist, there, so there will be n vectors x1, x2 up to xn such that Axi equal to lambda xi. So, can you tell me why this happens here? There exist non-zero vectors x1, x2 up to xn so that Axi equal to lambda I into xi. How will you get this one? See, you have to take care that they are non-zero vectors. How will you, why? See, what is the relation between determinant and singularity of a matrix? Determinant of A 0 means what? It is singular. Singular means what? There exists a non-zero vector x as Ax equal to 0. Okay, now apply that one. Okay. So, determinant of A minus lambda I, determinant of lambda I minus A is 0. Okay. So, Ax, A, there will be some vector. Okay, see, just write down this one, who can follow, who can, see determinant of lambda I, okay, see this stands for identity matrix, okay, identity matrix, this is 0, okay, so lambda I, lambda I minus A, it is singular matrix, okay. So, that means there is a vector x such that x is 0, okay. X is non-zero and it is in Cn, okay, Cn. Okay, see also I forgot to mention one more small thing here. See what is this notation Cn, okay. Cn is, see you collect all n tuples like this, okay, x1, x2 up to xn where each xi is a complex number. So, it is same as, see suppose you replace with this one Rn, Rn is what? You collect all numbers y1 to yn for each yi, is it not? Is it alright? Rn C. Okay, lambda I are the eigenvalues of A, okay, lambda I are the eigenvalues of A. Xi are eigenvectors of A, okay, Xi are eigenvectors of A, okay, see one more small thing here, suppose you have a eigenvector, okay, do you think that this X is unique or what? See, suppose corresponding to lambda 1, okay, then you have x1 here, okay. X1 is an eigenvector of A corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda 1. Question is whether this x1 is unique. No. Okay, any scalar multiple will also work. So any alpha times x1, okay. You multiply by a scalar alpha, then this will also be an eigenvector, okay. But I have to make sure that this alpha is not 0, okay. Alpha is not 0. Any non, non-zero multiple of xi, that will be an eigenvector, okay. Okay, xi are eigenvectors of A, okay. So, okay, now we will come to this one. See, whatever I taught you, see, whatever I talked, only the elementary things, okay. Now I will define something called spectral radius, okay. Spectral radius means, definition is, you consider the maximum of modulus of all the eigenvalues, okay. That is called the spectral radius of A, okay. Maximum of modulus of lambda 1, modulus of lambda 2, up to modulus of lambda. See, first of all, spectral radius is well defined, okay. It's well defined because I am taking only finitely many numbers. So, is it alright or not? See, I am taking only finitely many numbers, mod lambda 1, mod lambda 2, up to mod lambda n, okay. So, number of, so there are only n numbers are there. So, spectral radius of a matrix is well defined, okay. So, rho of A is called the spectral radius of A, okay. Very trivial. Spectral radius is always non-negative. Why? Yeah, maximum of non-negative numbers. So, rho of A is always non-negative, okay. Keep this in mind. Rho of A is always non-negative. Okay, so if A is non-zero, can we say that spectral radius is positive? Do you think that, is it always positive? Okay, see, first thing, see, before that, if A equal to 0, what happens? Spectral radius is? How do you know that? All the eigenvalues are 0, so maximum of 0, you are getting only 0, okay. So, you will avoid a 0, okay. If A is non-zero, can we say that rho of A is positive?
So, we can take
non-zero? Non-zero nilpotent matrix. Okay, see. See, suppose A is not 0, okay. So, A is not 0 means what? At least one entry, I should make sure that it's not 0, okay. So, let me construct a matrix like this. A is zero, one, zero, zero. Okay, what are the eigenvalues of A? Eigenvalues are?
Zero.
Zero. Okay, eigenvalues are zeros, okay, zero. It has two eigenvalues, right? It's a 2 by 2 matrix, two eigenvalues. What is the other eigenvalue? Again, other eigenvalue is also 0. Okay, what is the characteristic polynomial? Okay, x square. X square is this. X square is the character. Okay, x square is the characteristic polynomial. Okay, f of 0 is 0. Okay, so twice. A is a non-zero matrix. A is non-zero, okay, but the spectral radius is 0, okay. So, if A is non-zero, I can't say, conclude that rho of A is positive, okay. It can be even 0, remember that. For every invertible, rho of A, yeah, it should be, because see, if A is invertible, what will be the eigenvalues? Eigenvalue cannot be 0, okay. So, eigenvalue, if you, when you take the maximum of modulus, it will be bigger than 0, okay. See, find a 2 by 2 matrices such that a spectral radius is an eigenvalue, okay. What is the example that you will give? Any real? No, wrong. Any real symmetric matrix, will it? No. Spectral radius is an eigenvalue. This is an example. Spectral radius is 0, 0 is an eigenvalue, right? Okay. Speculative is not an eigenvalue. Diagonal matrix. Yeah, tell me this moment. Just to give one example. No, diagonal only you are telling. Minus 1. Minus 1, 0. Okay. So what is the spectral radius of this one? See, my matrix is this, just this one, okay? A. Diagonal, okay? Spectral radius is 1. Okay, spectral radius is 1. Okay, anyway, see, you told that any real symmetric, it's wrong. So, diagonal matrices are symmetric, okay? So, spectral radius is not an eigenvalue, okay?
So,
okay, it's all right. Okay. Anyway, see, I will say that a vector is positive if all the components are positive. Okay. See, this one will be coming across again and again, even next week when you hear this LCP lecture or like that. So, you'll be, they will tell you this one, non-negative vector and positive vector. Okay. Positive means, a vector is positive means every component is positive. Okay, even if at least one component is negative, then I will not tell that it's a positive vector. Remember that one, okay? X is positive if all the components are positive. Similarly, we have a non-negative vectors. Okay, non-negative vectors. See, just an example, 1, 2, 8, it's a positive vector in R3. Okay, 1, 2, 8, all the entries are positive. 1, 2, and 8. 1, 2, 0, not positive. Why? Third component is 0, so it's not positive, but it's a non-negative vector. Okay. 1, 2, minus 7 is not a non-negative vector. Third component is minus 1. Okay. Okay, see, for the future, just I will record this statement. Vectors I will write either as a row or column vectors. Okay. And depending on the context, you understand this one. Okay. For multiplication purpose, you have to. This one. So, anyway, what is the meaning for some vector is not non-negative?
Not order.
No, tell properly. Yeah, one component is at least negative, then only it's not non-negative. Okay. See, anyway, see, you have to keep this in mind. Okay. When you say, when you write a contradiction something, then there is at least one component which is not negative. Okay. If you want to prove that some vector is not non-negative, sorry. If you want to prove that some vector is non-negative. Okay, then you have to start like this. Suppose a component is negative, then okay, now you will come to this theorem, okay? Perron's theorem. Okay, Perron's theorem is about the positive matrices. Okay, Perron-Frobenius theorem, they extend it to non-negative matrices, but not for all non-negative matrices. It will be for a class of matrices called irreducible matrices. Okay. Anyway, see, right now we will concentrate only on positive matrices proved by Perron. Consider a positive matrix, okay? Then all these 5 statements are true, okay? That is Perron's theorem. A is a positive matrix, so then you can definitely say that rho of A is an eigenvalue of A. First statement, okay? Rho of A is an eigenvalue of A. That is a positive vector, okay? That is a positive vector y, such that Ay equal to rho of A into y. Okay. Anyway, I have written 2 times. Okay. Ignore that. And you can say something more about the eigenvalue rho of A. Okay. Rho of A, if you compute the geometric multiplicity, it is 1. Okay. In fact, I will show that, even tomorrow I will show that for it has algebraic multiplicity 1. Okay. But right now I will show the geometric multiplicity is 1. If Ax equal to lambda x for some x positive, okay, then x and y are linearly dependent. That y is a vector in the item 2, okay, y is vector in item 2. Okay, see, meaning for a fourth statement is, suppose there is a, see, can you have a positive vector, okay, other than the vector corresponding to the spectral radius? Okay, no, it should be a multiple of that vector. Okay. Anyway, see, for a future purpose, I will also give this a name here. Okay, rho of A, it is a Perron value of A. Rho of A. Peron eigenvalue of A. Okay, O of A is Peron eigenvalue of A. Peron vector is Peron vector means corresponding eigenvector. Corresponding eigenvector, these are corresponding to the spectral radius, Peron eigenvalue. Why corresponding positive? I will say that corresponding eigenvector is. Yes, sir. Okay, see, fifth one, it says that if AV equal to lambda V for some V greater than 0, then lambda should be rho spectral radius of A. Okay. See, if at all some positive vector is an eigenvector of A, okay, then the corresponding eigenvalue should be the spectral radius. Okay, that is the fifth conclusion of the theorem. Okay. Then I say, don't worry about 3, 4 and 5. Okay. That will come immediately once you prove the theorem. Okay. But showing 1 and 2 are really non-trivial. Okay. So anyway, how to show 1 and 2 here? See, there are several proofs for this Peron's theorem. Okay. Maybe the easiest way is by applying Brouwer's fixed point theorem. Anyway, morning Professor Raghavan told you this one. What is a Brouwer's fixed point theorem? Okay. So it's very easy to apply Brouwer's fixed point theorem. If you learn the statement, it's enough. Then you can prove this one, Peron's theorem. Otherwise, you have to handle with the inequalities and then you have to prove the theorem. Okay, that becomes somewhat messy. Anyway, I will follow this approach. Okay, how to prove Peron's theorem by applying Brouwer's fixed point theorem. Okay, under the proof, whatever I have given, okay, whatever I am going to tell, see, this is given in Bapat and Raghavan. Non-negative matrices. Okay, non-negative matrices and applications, right? And applications. Yeah, encyclopedia of mathematics. Okay, so. Encyclopedia in mathematics, sir. See, there is another book, very well known book written by Berman and Plemons. Okay, Berman and Plemons, anyway, I will write that reference also here. So, Abraham Berman and Robert Plemons. Non-negative matrices. It's a Siam series book. Okay, so latest edition comes from this one, Siam. Non-negative matrices in mathematics. Yeah, non-negative matrices in mathematical sciences. In mathematical sciences. Okay. See, Peron's theorem I have taken from this one, okay, Bapat and Raghavan. Frobenius theorem I have taken the proof from, see, it's written by Fiedler. Okay, Fiedler, special matrices and their applications in numerical mathematics. Numerical mathematics, okay. Numerical, no, on the applications in numerical methods, I think. Methods. Numerical methods. It's a Dover, okay. Dover classical book. Okay. Frobenius theorem I have taken from this book, okay. Fiedler book, which is a very nice book. This one. And What are proof that we will be seeing for Perron-Frobenius theory for cones? I have taken only from this one, permanent Plemons, okay, and nowhere it is given except permanent Plemons. Of course, it is a well-known book, Bapat and Raghavan, okay. Okay, see. Okay, before proceeding, okay, just verify, can you verify this one, Perron's theorem for this matrix? All entries are 1, so it's positive, okay. Can you verify Perron's theorem here? See, don't think that I have given you some n by n matrix and then as I am asking you to solve a very difficult problem. It's very easy. Why it's very easy? Even though it's n by n, okay, rank is 1. So, it's very easy to verify the theorem. So, why you tell me this one? Why n is n? Not n, okay, n, okay, yeah, you are correct, yes, yes. N is an eigenvalue, yeah. Okay, why first n is an eigenvalue, okay. Okay, others, what is this number n? N is? No, no, look, other story. What is n? N is the size of the matrix. Okay, I am considering n by n matrix. Okay, it's order n. Okay, n is fixed. So, n is an eigenvalue. Okay, what is the corresponding eigenvector? Okay, all 1s. AE is what? Okay, E is the vector of all 1s, 1, 1, 1, 1. AE is NE. Okay. So, what is the Perron eigenvalue here? Perron eigenvalue is N. N is an eigenvalue, rho of A. Okay. Perron vector is E. Perron vector is E. Okay. Okay, see, second point. Okay. If you take any other eigenvector, okay, if you take any other eigenvector, okay. If you take any other eigenvector, it's not, it will not be even non-negative. Why? If you take any other eigenvector of A other than E, I am saying, okay, it will not be a non-negative vector. Why? But you should apply some more theorem there. Why? How? Okay, see, before that, what are the other eigenvalues here? 0, okay. Why it is 0? Okay, rank of A is, but how do you know that rank is 1? Okay, all the coordinates are, all the coordinates are 1, that's how I gave the matrix. All the rows are 1, all the columns are 1, okay. So, all the columns are 1, otherwise A can be written as this matrix, right? E transpose by a multiple, right? I think by n, right? E transpose by n. Is it all right or not? E transpose.
Simply.
No, no. 1, 1, 1, 1. You are divide by n. So A is E transpose by n. Okay. Okay. Leave that multiple. Okay. 1 by n is nothing. So just generated by only 1 vector. Okay. E transpose. Okay. So 1 into E transpose plus 0 into remaining things. Okay. 0. That's all. Sorry. A is E transpose by n. Okay. So column space of A is generated by vector 1, vector of all 1s. Okay. So it has rank 1. Okay. So other eigenvalues are zeros. Okay. So other eigenvalues are zeros means 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay. 0 is repeated n minus 1 times. Algebraic multiplicity of 0 will be n minus 1. Okay, algebraic multiplicity is n minus 1, which is same, will be, which is same as geometric multiplicity also, because matrix symmetric. Okay, okay, see, A is E transpose by n. Okay, and I asked you, suppose you take any other eigenvalue, okay, sorry, you take any other eigenvector, okay, corresponding to 0, then you can't get a non-negative vector. Why?
Yeah,
yeah. Huh? Okay. Yes, yes, yeah, exactly. So, see, that's a very, very simple answer. Okay. So, AX is 0. Okay. All the entries of A are 1. So, some entry should be negative. So that they cancel and then you get 0. Okay. Is it all right or not? So, you can verify this one. Perron's theorem is true, right? See, okay. See, to prove Perron's theorem, we need some tools, okay. So, whatever, see, just elementary things, this one, okay. So, basically, you need a topology, okay. If you don't know the word topology, don't get afraid. So, I am not going to use any of these things. I need this notion of distance, okay. So, there are two vectors in Rn, x and y, okay. Components are denoted like this, x1, x2 up to xn, y equal to y1, y2 up to yn. So, norm of x minus y, okay. There are two, okay, so this symbol means that norm of a vector x, okay, norm n over rm, okay. See, the word norm has analogous meanings. First one, norm is equivalent to length or magnitude, okay. Whatever is convincing for you, use the word, okay. Norm, magnitude, length, they all are the same, okay. Anyway, I will use the word norm, okay. Norm of x minus y will be the notation used to denote the distance between x and y. Okay, norm of x is what? Distance between x and the origin. Okay, norm of x minus 0. Okay, so norm x. How I am going to define the distance is the standard way of defining the distance. See, there are several ways how you can define a norm. Okay. Anyway, I will take the standard one here. Norm of x equal to root of x1 square plus x2 square up to xn square. Why I call it a standard is that, this is a natural thing that you have learnt in this one, analytical geometry of two dimensions. Okay, when you have a distance, okay, in xy plane. So, this is a way how you measure the distance between two elements in xy plane. So, norm of x equal to x1 square plus x2 square plus xn square. So, in general, norm of x minus y is what? x1 minus y1 square plus x2 minus y2 square and so on. Okay, and then you have to take the positive square root, remember that. Okay, see, once I have defined this distance, I can define what is called a convergent sequence in Rn. So, x1, x2 up to x3, they are all convergent in Rn. Sorry, you consider a sequence, okay, sequence of vectors. So, we say that limit k going to xk equal to p, okay, if for each epsilon there is a positive integer m such that after some stage, okay, k greater than or equal to m, norm of xk minus p is less than epsilon, okay. Okay, say, how will you show that this sequence is not convergent? 1, 0, minus 1, 0, 1, 0, minus 1, 0. See, first of all, do you agree that it's a sequence, right? First element is 1, 0, second element minus 1, 0, third element 1, 0. Okay, it alternates. Okay, it's not convergent. Why? How will you show that it's not convergent? How will you show? How do you know that there is a limit? First of all, not even one possibility is there. Then what will you do? What are the two is convergence? How will you do this? Okay, see, standard way how you can prove this one is, assume that it is convergent, okay, then there is a, that means that there is a limit, okay, now we get a contradiction, okay. Okay, see, assume that it converges to xy, okay, xy, then what can be y? Y can be only? Y can be only 0, okay, and x is either minus 1 or plus 1, okay, if you can, okay, it's all right, if you can show that x is a minus 1 or plus 1, then you appeal to the standard saying that a sequence cannot have two different limits, okay, if you appeal to the theorem also, then you can finish the proof, okay. Anyway, see, I will assume that, okay, this thing is convergent central, so, Huh, is it all right in there? Okay, see, basically what you are here. Yeah, okay. That's all right. Okay, see, basically what you have to do is that you have to deal with only with the sets that are called closed, okay. A set is called closed if any convergent sequence xm in f satisfies the following. If xm converges to a limit, then that limit should belong to the set f, okay. So it encloses all the limit points. That's how you define this one, closed set, okay. Rn plus is a closed set, okay. Rn plus, okay, Rn plus is I have to Rn plus is you collect all the vectors x and x so that all are non-negative. Okay. All are non-negative. Suppose you are in the xy plane, then you are collecting all the vectors in this. Okay, including the boundary. That's very important. You are including the boundary. Okay, so that's Rn plus. Rn plus is closed. Okay. Anyway, Rn plus is closed. I leave it to you as an exercise, okay. Maybe in the tutorial you can show that Rn plus is closed, okay. How will you show that Rn plus plus, okay, Rn plus plus, I will define this, Rn plus plus. You collect all vectors where x is positive, okay, collect all positive vectors, okay, you know what is positive vector now. Collect all positive vectors, that is Rn plus plus. So that means that what, in the xy plane I am ignoring the boundary. Okay, I am collecting, see, I am looking only at the first quadrant here, interior of the first quadrant. So this is Rn plus plus. Rn plus plus, it's not a closed set. Why? Madam, how will you show that Rn plus plus is not closed? How will you prove this one? Rn plus plus, just appeal to the definition, okay. If you have a convergent sequence, okay, xn in Rn plus plus, and if it converges to a limit, it should not be in, it will not be in Rn plus plus, then you can show that, then by definition it follows that Rn plus plus is not closed. How will you prove this one? How will you get a sequence, a nice sequence like this? It's very easy, very easy. Okay, see, I will give you an example. See, first one, how will you construct a sequence of positive numbers converging to 0? How will you construct a sequence of positive numbers converging to 1 by n? But is it the 1 by n is the only sequence or what? N square will not converge. So, n square, what? N square, it will go somewhere. N square is not even bounded. So, give me some other sequence. One more example of a convergent sequence. Give me one sequence at least, other than 1 by n, 1 by 2 n, okay, 1 by 2 power n, 1 by 3 power n, okay, okay, see it's alright, okay, 1 by 2 power n converges to 0, okay. Now can you show that Rn plus plus is not closed, okay, see I will just simply take 1 by n, 1 by n, okay, 1 by n, 1 by n, maybe see if you are working in Rn plus plus, then n dimension, then take a sequence like this, 1 by n, 1 by n, up to 1 by n, okay, all are positive vectors, so it converges to 0, but 0 is not in Rn plus plus, okay, Rn plus plus is not closed. See, it's important that you understand closed sets, otherwise maybe little difficult to understand the whole theorem, okay. Okay, see, one more theorem, see, one more definition I will give you, okay. Maybe this is the last definition, I won't bore you much, okay. Bounded, okay. A set E in Rn is bounded if there is a K so that whatever vector you take from that set, okay, it will be bounded by a number k. Okay, see, for example, if you take a unit disk, so let me take this one. So, see, I work in R2, okay, xy, x square plus y square less than or equal to 1. Do you think that this set is bounded or what? Or not? E is bounded or not? How do you know that it's E is bounded? Now, so what is the k here? K is 1. K is 1, that's fine. You take any vector, okay, what is the norm of x? Square root of x square plus y square less than 1, less than or equal to 1. Okay. Okay, give me an example of a set which is not bounded. Okay. What 2 power n? 2 power n means what? What is the? Let them tell me. Okay, whole Rn. Whole Rn is not bounded. Why? Okay, whole Rn is not bounded. How will you prove that whole Rn is not bounded? Okay, see, whole Rn is not bounded. Okay, Rn is not bounded. How will you write a proof for this one? Suppose there is a k, okay, suppose it is bounded, suppose Rn is bounded, then there exists k. Okay, this is a notation for there exists k such that norm of x is less than or equal to k for any x in Rn. Okay, but now we'll construct a vector whose norm exists k. Okay, how will you get a vector? So construct a vector x whose norm exists k. Okay, that's very easy. X equal to 2k 0 0. Okay, norm x is 2k. This is greater than k. Okay, 2k. So it is an unbounded set. Okay, but proving Rn is not bounded, that's not a great thing. Okay. There are subsets of Rn which are not unbounded, which are not bounded. Okay. For example, if you take Rn plus is not bounded. Okay. Rn plus is not bounded. Suppose Rn plus is not bounded, then there exists, it is bounded. Then there exists a case as the norm of x less than or equal to k. Choose x equal to 2k 0 0 0. It's a vector in Rk plus. So it is unbounded. Okay. Rn plus is unbounded. Okay, see, now I will come to what are called compact sets. A set in Rn is said to be compact if and only if it is closed and bounded. Okay, if it is closed as well as bounded, it's compact. Okay, see, unbounded sets means what? Sets that are not bounded. Okay, that's the meaning for unbounded sets. Okay, see, for our purpose, I will use this delta again and again. Delta is collect all vectors which are non-negative, as well as sigma I equal to 1 to n, as well as we sum those vectors which is less than or equal to 1. Okay, it is compact. Okay, so how will you show that this delta is a compact set? How will you show that delta is a compact? Why? See, suppose you take a sequence, okay, delta is compact. Why? How will you show that delta is compact? Suppose xn, okay, is a sequence. This is a delta. Okay. So xn is in delta for every n. Okay. Let xn converges to some point x star. Then you have to show that x star belongs to delta. Okay, why? Okay, see, one way to prove that is, see, first one, intersection of any closed sets is closed. Okay, if you intersect any closed set, they will be closed. Can you recognize delta as a intersection of two closed sets? X such that x greater than or equal to 0, okay, intersect with x such that sigma I equal to 1 to any xi less than or equal to 1. Okay, so these two are closed sets. If you show them separately, okay, then intersection of closed sets is closed, so it is closed. Also bounded, boundedness is very simple here. Why it is bounded? What is the k here? What is the k? K is 1, okay. Can I take k equal to 2? No. I can as well take any number greater than 1, okay. K greater than 1, okay. So it's bounded, okay. So this set is compact, okay. Sigma I equal to 1 to n, xi less than, okay, fine. Anyway, see, further examples I have written here. See, open interval 0, 1 cross closed interval 0, 1 is not closed in R2. Okay, they're all, these are all non-trivial examples, okay. 1 by n comma 2, if you take, it's a sequence in E. But the limit of this sequence is 0 comma 1 by 2. Okay, but it's not a point in E, because first one is open 0, 1. Okay, and the second one, if you take E, Y1, Y2, where Y1 greater than equal to 0, Y2 greater than equal to 0, it's closed but not compact. Okay, it's an example of a closed set which is not compact. So you may think that every closed set is compact. No. So because this is an unbounded set. Okay, it's an unbounded set. You can take a sequence like this, n comma n. It's an unbounded, so you can not compact. Okay, see, I will define one more thing. It's called convex sets. Okay, convex set. Consider any closed set in Rn. Okay. So, if you consider any closed set in Rn, it is called convex if the midpoint of any two vectors, if you take inside the set x and y, okay, then the midpoint lies in S. Okay, that's the meaning for the convex set. Okay, see, one small deviation from the standard definition here. I am starting with a closed set. For my purpose, it will be enough. Okay, I will start with a closed set and then I define what is define the convexity. Okay, so if x is in S and y is in S, then the midpoint is in S. That's enough. Okay. Okay. If you take delta as x1, x2, okay, so that x1 square plus x2 square less than or equal to 1, then delta is convex. So how will you prove this one? Okay, assume that delta is closed. Okay, I am not asking you to prove that delta is closed. Assume that delta is closed, then how can you verify this one? Delta is convex. See, let x belongs to delta, y belong to delta. Okay, how will you show that x plus y belongs to delta? How will you prove this one? Okay, angle inequality, you need that one. Yeah. See, okay, write x as x1, x2. Y is y1, y2. Okay. What is x plus y by 2? X plus y by 2 is, see, how to add two vectors? Coordinate wise, you have to add. Okay. X1 plus y1 by 2. This is x2 plus y2 by 2. Okay. Now compute the squares. So x1 square, x1 plus y1 by 2 square. Plus x2 plus y2 by square. Okay. So will it be less than or equal to 1? If you can show that less than or equal to 1, then you are true. Okay. But how will you show that it's less than or equal to 1? X1 plus y1 by 2. So how do you know that it is less than or equal to 1? See, what is given here? X1 square plus x2 square is less than or equal to 1. Y1 square plus y2 square is less than or equal to 1. Both these things are given to you. Okay. Now can you prove this one? It will be no. No? Okay. Expand and apply. This one you want to expand. X1 square plus y1 square plus, okay, this by 2, this is x1 by 4, by 4 then by 2 then plus x2 square plus y2 square by 4 plus by 2 then x1 y1. On AMG, how do you know that x1 is non-negative? Okay, this one x1 square is this implies 2 2 x1 x2, okay, less than or equal to 1. So similarly this will imply that 2 y1 y2 is less than or equal to 1. So this is less than or equal to 1 by 4. Then? Okay. Okay, solid. This is solid. Anyway, see, showing that some set is convex, it's not easy. Okay. Unless you manipulate with inequalities, you can't get. Okay, see, next one may be simple. So this is not convex. Why? X1 square plus x2 square equal to 1. So see, previously my delta was less 1. Okay. But now I am taking only the points on the boundary. It's not convex. Why? Very simply, see, you can proof is very easy, I think. Why? Huh? Okay, 1001. 101, this belongs to delta, okay, this is on the boundary, but how about the midpoint? 1 by 2, 1 by 2, 1 by 2, 1 by 2 is not here, right? 1 by 2, 1 by 2 is not on the boundary, because 1 by 2 square plus 1 by 2 square is what? It's not 1, it is less than 1, okay, so it will be here somewhere, inside this, okay. So that's not convex, okay. Anyway, see, it's enough, okay. So whatever I told you about compact, closed, convex, okay, this is enough for us. Okay, see, first step in the proof, okay. What is the first assertion? Perron's theorem, first assertion is spectral radius is always an eigenvalue of a positive matrix, okay. Some positive, okay, first step, how I will do it is, see, consider you take a positive matrix, okay. So in the first step, I will show that some positive number is an eigenvalue, first of all. Okay, that itself I don't know. Given here a positive matrix, how can I conclude that it has a positive eigenvalue? Okay. So first step will be to show that some positive number is always an eigenvalue. Okay. At least I will prove the minimum thing first. Okay. So for this, I will use this Brouwer's fixed point theorem. Okay. Okay, so I will tell you what is this one, Brouwer's fixed point theorem, okay. Let delta be a compact and convex set, okay, compact convex set. Suppose f is a continuous function, then there is a fixed point for f, okay. A point is called a fixed point if f of x equal to x, okay. So any continuous function has the, on a, defined on a self map, sorry, any continuous function, okay, it should be a self map. Otherwise, there is no meaning in defining a fixed point. F should be from delta to delta. Okay. Let delta be a compact and convex set. If there is a x such that f of x equal to x. Okay, that's the conclusion of this theorem. Sorry, Brouwer's fixed point theorem. Okay, see, Brouwer's fixed point theorem. If n equal to 1, it's a standard problem in the first year calculus course. Okay, but if you go to higher dimensions, proving this theorem, it's not easy. Even for R2 to R2, it's not easy to prove this one, Brewer's fixed point theorem. But n equal to 1, you could have seen the theorem. How? What is that statement here? If n equal to 1, okay, n equal to 1, how will you prove this one? See, first of all, n equal to 1, n equal to 1 means what? F is a continuous function of, continuous function from, okay, it's a subset of R to R, okay. But a subset is also, I am assuming that delta is compact as well as convex, okay. Only possibility of such sets are intervals, okay. And not only intervals, they are closed on bounded intervals, okay. Closed on bounded intervals. So, in the case R, okay, delta will be AB. Delta is AB. F is from delta to delta, okay. How will you prove this one here? So you have a function like this. I also know that F is continuous, okay. How to show that there is a fixed point? Fixed point means what? There is a P such that F of P equal to P. How will you prove this one in one dimensional case? Okay. G of x equal to, okay, f of x minus x, it's all right, okay. Then closer. Rolle's theorem. Rolle's theorem and all doesn't come into the picture. See, Brewer's theorem, it is all about continuous functions. I am not bringing any calculus inside here. You see, you should not assume differentiability, etc. Okay. Intermediate value theorem, okay. Intermediate value theorem. But how will you apply this intermediate value theorem? What is intermediate value theorem, first of all? What is intermediate value theorem? Intermediate value theorem means what? Okay, see, suppose f of x equal to alpha. Suppose f of y equal to beta, okay. Assume that alpha less than beta, okay. Alpha less than beta, then you take any number gamma inside alpha and beta, okay. Let alpha less than gamma less than beta, then you can solve this equation. F of x equal to gamma is a solution, okay. F of x equal to gamma is a solution. That's a meaning for intermediate value. See, there is an intermediate value gamma like in between alpha and beta, okay. For that gamma, I can solve the equation f of x equal to gamma. That's a intermediate value theorem, okay. If you apply the intermediate value theorem, it will come immediately. How to prove this one? Anyway, as I told, if g of x equal to f of x minus x, okay, then g of a is g of a is what? F of a minus a. F of a is at least a because it's a self map. Okay, so f of a minus a is greater than or equal to 0. G of b is f of b minus b. F of b is okay. F of b anyway, it should be less than or equal to b. Okay, so it is less than or equal to 0. Okay, and if it is 0, then I am done. See, if both are zeros, okay, this if the inequality is actually the equality, then I am done. There is nothing to prove. A and B will be the fixed point, okay. Suppose they are strict, then only there is a problem. But now apply the intermediate value theorem. One is positive and then another is negative. Zero should be in between. So, there is a fixed point for this, okay. See, it comes very easily by if you apply fixed point theorem in the one dimensional case. Sorry, not fixed point. Intermediate value theorem. But n equal to 2, it's very difficult, okay. Anyway, see, proof is not straightforward. See, if you know degree theory, you can prove. If you know maybe algebraic topology also, you can prove. Otherwise, maybe these two only I know. Beyond that, I don't know this. Anyway, see, forget about the proof of Brewer's fixed point theorem, okay. If you understand the statement, it's well and good, okay. So, nowhere the technique of proof is used. Okay, Brewer's fixed point theorem. Statement is is the most important thing there. Okay, see, if A is a positive, okay, first observation, if it is a positive matrix, then if you take any non-negative vector, okay, then A y should be positive, okay, unless it's zero. Why? See, this is a, statement may appear to be very simple, but it's very, very useful here. See, it is a, this statement is a ultimate statement where they will be using again and again. If A is positive and if you take a non-negative vector, unless it is zero, it will be positive. A y is always positive. How? Okay, see, listen here. A is something like this, A1, A2, up to AN. Okay. Okay. See, I am given a positive matrix. That means that all the entries are going to be positive. Okay. If I multiply with a non-negative vector, okay, take a non-zero vector. Okay. If y is zero, then what is AY? If y is 0, what is AY? AY is 0. Okay? Don't consider 0 vector. Okay? You consider any other vector, okay, which is non-negative, then that means that you are going to do this one, Aij into yj, right? Aij into yj. So, I is from 1 to n. Is it alright or? J is from 1 to n. Yeah. J is from 1 to n. Okay, Aij is a positive number, yj is non-negative. Okay, if some component is negative, okay, this is the way how the ith component is defined. Okay, ith. So, if Ayi is 0, that means that the sum is 0. Okay, then there is no other way. See, all the Aijs are positive, and yij, unless it is greater, unless it is 0, you won't get this one. Okay, so it is always positive here. See, this is a very, very important observation, okay, very simple, but it's very effective. This statement is not true if I just assume that A is greater than or equal to 0. Do you agree this one? If I simply assume that the matrix is non-negative, this statement is not true. For some example, can you give? Don't take 0, okay, I told you that you ignore 0 matrix. If the 0, you can do nothing in this world. 0, 1, 0, 0. Okay, that's all right. 0, 1, 0, 0. So, this is my A. Okay. What is a Y? Y is? 1, 0. AY is what? AY is 0. AY becomes 0. Okay. AY is 0. Now, even if you take 1, then also it's. Even I take 1 here, will it be? No, no, no. Okay, AY is what? What is AY? AY is? Yeah, AY is 1, 0, right? 1 into 1, 1. Yeah, this is 0. Not true. Okay. See, one component is becomes 0. Okay. So, why? My example is 1101. Why do you prevent me from taking this exam? No, A is non-negative. Okay. See, A is non-negative. I have a non-zero vector. Okay. I have AY. One component is 0. Okay. It's a counter exercise. So, see, what I want to tell you is that if you take a non-negative matrix, that statement no longer remains true. Okay. See, this is a good example. 1101. Okay. One component is not 0. So, if you take AY, it becomes positive, okay, that's a crucial observation here. See, anyway, to apply Brouwer's fixed point theorem, okay, we need one compact set, which is also convex, okay, and we need a continuous function, f from delta to delta, then I can apply Brouwer's fixed point theorem, but randomly, if you take any continuous function, that will not work. It should be associated with that A. So, remember that A is a given positive matrix, okay. So, how will you apply Brouwer's fixed point theorem here? How will you construct a suitable continuous function here? So I am defining delta here like this, okay. Delta is x such that sigma I equal to 1 to n, x I equal to 1 and x I greater than equal to 0. Okay, I told you that this set is compact as well as convex. Okay, so collect all the vectors, non-negative vectors whose sum is 1. Okay, collect all non-negative vectors, and if you sum, if you take any vector inside that set and if you sum that, it will be 1. Okay, see, for example, if you take 1 by 2, okay, 1 by, see, if, suppose you are in R3, I take 1 by 3, 1 by 3, 1 by 3, okay, it is a point in delta. Okay, so this set is compact and convex. I told you this one. Okay, so this is compact. So this is the set in which I will be working on here. Okay, so how to construct this continuous self map? So we are given a positive matrix. So I am going to define g of x. G of x is first entry of Ax. Okay, x is a given vector in delta. So now I am going to define g of x. G of x is first entry of Ax. Okay, A is already known to you. A is already the positive matrix which is known to you. First entry of Ax plus second entry of Ax plus third entry of A of x and sum up to nth entry of A of x. Okay, so g of x. Okay, I know that ith component of Ax is always positive. Why? Why? A is positive, x is non-negative, but x can be 0, right? Why? Sum should be 1. So I have already ignored a 0 vector. Okay, so Axi is positive for all I. Okay, that's very sure. Okay, g of x not equal to 0 for all x in delta. G of x cannot be a 0 vector because we are going to sum only positive. Okay. So this is the continuous function that I am going to consider. Okay, see, if again, see, same thing, if I start with a non-negative matrix, okay, and the same g, then g of p may be 0 for some p, okay, the same argument doesn't go through. That's why it's not, this argument is not true for non-negative matrices. This argument, Brouwer's fixed point theorem argument, it's true only for, not true, okay, no, this is applicable only for positive matrices. Okay, so this consider this example 0, 1, 0, 0, already I told you this one. So where the same map g of e1 will be 0. Okay, so g will not be a self map. If you start with the non-negative matrices and then work with the same g, okay, g will not be a self map. So you can't apply this Brouwer's fixed point theorem. But if you start with a kind of positive matrix, everything goes very well. Okay, so my f will be like this. F of x, f is equal to f of x equal to ax by g of x. Okay, g of x is a positive real number, so dividing by g of x is meaningful. Okay, ax divided by g of x. A is okay, f is continuous. Why? F is continuous. Why? Okay, see, A is continuous. Any linear map on a finite dimensional space is continuous. G of x is g is one, not only non-zero. G is again continuous map. Okay, g is again a continuous map. So a of x by g of x is continuous. Okay, how will you show that f is a self map? F is from delta to delta. Okay, if you want to show that it is from delta to delta, you have to sum all the components. F of x1 plus f of x2 till f of xn is what? Okay, okay, f of x 1 is what? Ax first entry of Ax divided by g of x. Okay, f of x in the second entry, okay, Ax 2 by g of x, and then you have the nth entry. Okay, by g of x. Okay, so you sum all these things, so this is equal to, so g of x is common. Okay, g of x is common, and then ax1 plus axn. Okay, axn, but what is the numerator here? G of x. This is one. Okay, so If you take any vector in this one, okay, f of x1, if you take any vector in the image of f, okay, and if you sum all these things, you will get 1, and also it is a non-negative vector, that is trivial, okay. If each f of xi is greater than or equal to 0, because a of x set by positive number, okay, and a is already a positive matrix and x is a non-negative vector. So, f is your self map, okay, f is your self map, delta is compact convex, f is continuous, okay. So, you can apply Brouwer's fixed point theorem now. Okay, see, I have constructed a very nice map f from delta to delta. Okay. So, there is a fixed point for f. Okay, there is a fixed point for f. So, let me call that fixed point by y. F of y equal to y. Okay. By definition, what is f? F of y is what? 1 by g of y into ay. Okay, that is the definition of f. Okay, f of y equal to y, okay, so a y should be g of y into y, okay, g of y into y, g of y is positive, g of y is always positive, okay, y is not 0, y, f is from delta to delta, right, so y cannot be 0.
Y is 0, the sum of the coordinates of your f of y.
Y is a point in delta, right? So delta can delta 0 is not in delta. So y is not 0. Okay. So a of y equal to g of y into y. So y is not 0. That ensures that y is an eigenvector. Okay. That makes sure that y is an eigenvector. So y is in delta. G of y is positive by a definition. Okay. How I have defined g. So in fact y is positive. Okay. In fact y is positive. Y is a positive. Y is positive, why? A is a positive matrix and y is a non-negative vector. So, a, y is positive. Okay. So, anyway, I have shown this following. Okay. This lemma I have shown. Suppose A is a positive, then there is a positive real number delta such that Ay equal to delta y and y is positive. Okay. So, up to this point, I have proved this one. See, to complete the first assertion of this Brouwer's fixed point theorem, okay, I have to show that delta is rho of A. I know that there is some positive eigenvalue for A, but what is the guarantee that that positive eigenvalue is the same as the spectral radius, okay, that you have to show this one, okay. So, you want to show that the two numbers are equal, delta and rho of A, okay. By definition, delta less than or equal to rho of A. Is it all right or not? By definition, delta is less than or equal to rho of A. Because rho of A is the maximum of all the eigenvalues in modulus. Delta is a positive eigenvalue already. So, delta less than or equal to rho of A. Just if I prove the reverse inequality, then it will be true. Okay. Ay equal to delta y, y greater than 0, delta greater than 0, that's known to me. Okay. Okay, see. Instead of A, suppose I started with A transpose. Okay. If A is a positive matrix, A transpose is also a positive matrix. Is it all right? Okay, I am just transposing the entries. Nothing else I am doing. So, A transpose is also positive. Okay, I can apply the lemma to A transpose as well. Okay, so conclusion of that is that there is a U such that A transpose U is alpha 2 into U, where U is positive and alpha 2 is also positive. Okay, if I apply that lemma to A transpose, then I will get this one. U transpose A is alpha 2 into U transpose. Okay, so keep this in mind. Okay, so okay, see, if I want to prove the theorem, okay, see, first step, what I will do is I will show that this alpha 2 and delta, they coincide. Okay, alpha 2 and delta coincide. Okay, so I am rewriting this one equation here. A transpose U is alpha 2 U. Okay, just to transpose this one. Left hand side, if you transpose, what will you get? U transpose A. What is a transpose of the right hand side? Okay, alpha 2 into U transpose. So, I have written this one. U transpose A equal to alpha 2 into U transpose. Okay. See, always, see, in this one, you write down U transpose as a rho vector. It's a rho vector. So, U is what? column vector. Okay, U is column vector. See, U transpose AY post multiply by Y. Okay, U transpose AY is alpha 2 times U transpose Y. Okay, is it already done? Okay, already I know that AY is a delta Y. Okay, delta is a positive eigenvalue that already obtained by applying Brouwer's fixed point theorem. Okay, and Y is positive. So AY equal to delta Y and Y is positive. Okay, U and Y are positive vectors. So if you compute U transpose Y, okay, what is U transpose Y? Dot product of U and Y. Dot product of U and Y, is it always positive or not? U1 Y1 plus U2 Y2 till UN YN. Each UI and VI are positive. So if you compute the transpose, okay, U transpose Y is positive. Okay. So if you apply one, U transpose delta Y is alpha 2 into U transpose Y. Is it all right? Okay. Now, does it mean that alpha 2 and delta, they are equal? Okay, Y. Anyway, see, this equation is true. Alpha 2 minus delta into U transpose Y is 0. So, alpha 2 should be delta Y. U transpose Y is a positive. So, product of two numbers is 0. One is positive. So, other one should be 0. So, alpha 2 and delta are equal. Okay. So far I have proved this one. See, if you start with a positive matrix, then there is a delta such that then there is a delta, as well as I have two non-zero vectors which are positive vectors, in fact x and u, such that ax is equal to delta x and a transpose u is also delta u, same delta. Okay, and x and u are positive. Okay, next step I will show that a delta is rho of a. Okay, first I will prove this one. First now you return. Okay, I will prove that a delta equal to rho of a. Okay. Okay, see, before that, I will introduce this notation here. See, suppose you have two vectors, okay, x and y, then I will write x greater than or equal to y, if and only if the ith component of x minus y is non-negative. Huh? Oh, 5 more minutes. I started late, right? So, no, if I don't finish it today, then I have to... Maybe 15 minutes I will want, but the tutorials I can compensate. I will take a break then. Okay, so, tutorial for some 15 minutes I will take, then I will complete the proof and then, because suppose I don't do this one, then I have to start this Perron's theorem tomorrow. So directly you can start for Frobenius theorem tomorrow, otherwise continuity will be lost then. Okay, that's all right. Okay, see, suppose x greater than or equal to y, then ith component of x minus y is greater than or equal to 0. Okay, anyway, see, listen here. See, the technique that I will be applying is that, see, suppose you have a complex vector, okay, cn. Okay, I define a function, okay, m of x means modulus of x. Okay, modulus of that vector means take modulus to each of these components. Okay, so that the right hand side you get a non-negative vector. Okay, is it all right or not? If you start with a vector cn, okay, and then I apply this function m, then I get a non-negative vector on the right hand side. Okay, m of x equal to mod x1 up to mod x. So m of x is a non-negative vector in Rn. Okay, in my notation m of x is greater than or equal to 0. Okay, anyway, this, see, verifying this is, it's very simple. If eta is any complex number, m of eta x turns out to be mod eta into m of mod x. Do you agree this one or not? Because modulus of lambda, see, this eta will appear inside the modulus term everywhere. And the eta, you can take it out. Mod eta, you can take it out. So, that will come outside the vector. Okay. Okay, see, see, you can show that, okay, I will skip this one, but then you can prove this one. It's very, very easy. A into mod u is always greater than or equal to modulus of au. Okay. It's very easy. Just a triangle inequality you have to apply. Okay. Mod au is am of u is greater than or equal to m of au. Okay. So, anyway, this I am skipping. Okay. The only technique that is used in proving this inequality is a triangle inequality, not more than that. Okay. So, Now A is positive, you assume that A is positive.
So
A is positive because, no, no, why I need A is positive because on the left hand side, if you see, I have A here. If you don't put that A, if you don't assume that A is positive, then you can't remove that modulus in the final step. So that's why you have to assume that A is positive. Okay. So these entries are positive, no? So that's why you have to assume that A is positive. Okay. Okay, so A m of u minus A m of A u is always greater than or equal to 0. Okay, up to this step I know. Okay, I will just apply this this one and then conclude that the spectral radius is an eigenvalue of A. Okay, so how to finish the proof here? Consider any eigenvector. Okay, consider any eigenvector. Maybe call that vector by mu. Okay, so I have taken mu here. Corresponding eigenvector is what? B. Okay, that's what I have taken. So take any eigenvalue mu and then corresponding eigenvalue P. A P equal to mu times P. Okay. Already I know that A m of P is greater than or equal to m of AP. Okay, that inequality I have already derived. Okay, but m of AP is what? M of mu P by definition. Okay, but m of mu P is mod mu comes out. Okay, so this is how this the spectral radius comes into the picture. Modulus of the eigenvalue I have pulled it out. Okay, modulus of mu into P. Okay, now use the following also. I know that A transpose U equal to delta U. Okay, same delta and then U is positive. Now pre multiply by U transpose in A m of P greater than or equal to mod mu into P, that okay. So U transpose into A m of P greater than or equal to U transpose into mod mu into m of P. Okay. So anyway, this inequality is required to curve, is all that I need to show that delta is greater than or equal to mod mu. So U transpose A, I know that it's delta U transpose. So delta U transpose into m of p greater than or equal to mod mu into U transpose into m of p. U transpose into m of p is never 0. Why? U is positive vector, m of p is a non-negative vector, okay, which is not 0. So U transpose into m of p can never be 0. So that means that delta is greater than or equal to mod mu. Okay. So delta greater than or equal to mod mu. So how does this imply that the spectral radius is an eigenvalue? For any eigenvalue, I have shown that delta greater than or equal to mod mu. So that means that delta should be greater than or equal to rho. Okay, so delta should be the spectral radius of A. Okay, so for a positive matrix, spectral radius is always an eigenvalue. So if you do all these things, then it will come out easily. Okay.